So the gospel says she went to anoint him. So we are asking, you see this Hebrew word, anoint means is masaha. Masaha means to rub, to massage, to anoint. So we are asking the Christian, he says, do Jews massage dead bodies after 3 days, do they? Because within 3 hours rigor mortis sets in, you know, the hardening of the cells. The body starts fermenting from inside. Such a rotting body, when you massage it, falls to pieces. Does it make sense? After 3 days, she wants to go and massage a dead rotting body. Do Jews do that? Ask the Jews. They say no. I say, you Christians, do you massage dead bodies after 3 days? The answer is no. We Muslims, we are the closest to the Jew. Do we massage dead bodies after 3 days? Do you? You Muslims, do you? No. We are closest to the Jew in our ceremonial law. Then why should a Jewess want to go along and wanting to massage a dead rotting body? So she goes there and she's worried about the tomb, not a great tomb. And when she goes there, she finds that the stone is removed. She was worried about the stone. Who's going to remove the stone? She's alone. The stone is removed and she looks inside, the winding sheet inside. So she starts to cry. Now, let us cry for our brothers and sisters at the back for a few seconds, if you don't mind. There is a crunch there at the back. Mr. Chairman, is there any way you can solve some problem? What is it?
There are a few empty seats in front here for the ladies who are standing at the back. Could the gents then offer their seats to these ladies if there ain't more? Yes, and there are some gents on that side. That side was reserved for the ladies. There are also seats on the stage for the gents, please, which we have stopped now to help you. If those people there, please come to the stage.
I'm sorry, I'm showing my back to you, my brothers and sisters.
Thank you. There are still some men sitting on that side. Please, could you offer those seats to the ladies?
Shall we? So the lady starts to cry. It's an anti-climax to what she had expected. Jesus was watching her from wherever he was, not from heaven, but from this earth. You see, this tomb was a privately owned property belonging to Joseph of Arimathea, a secret disciple of Jesus, a very rich, influential Jew who could afford to carve out of a rock a big roomy chamber, which according to Jim Bishop, a Christian authority, he says it was 5 feet wide by 7 feet high by 15 feet deep with a ledge of ledges inside. Around that tomb was his vegetable garden. Now don't tell me that this Jew was so generous, he was planting vegetables 5 miles out of town for other people's sheep and goats to graze upon. I know Jews don't do that. No Christians, no Muslims will do silly things like that. He must have got his gardener's quarters, people to look after his garden, and perhaps his country home where he went during the weekend for his holiday with his family. Jesus is there, he sees this woman, he knows who she is, and he comes up to her and he says, Fro warum wien ye bisukye? Says, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? I'm asking, doesn't he know? Why does he ask such a silly question? He knows that she's looking for him. And he knows she's disappointed, she's crying. Why does he ask such a silly question? I said, no, it's not a silly question. Actually, he's pulling her leg, metaphorically. He's still got the sense of humor. Says, Fro warum wien ye bisukye? Say, he's heading the detainer was. She supposing him to be the gardener. I say, why does she suppose he's a gardener? Do resurrected bodies look like gardeners? Do they? That everybody, all of us, when we are resurrected, everybody will look like a gardener. So the wife can't make out a husband. She doesn't know the difference between the husband and the son-in-law. She's confused. And her grandfather and her father, everybody's the same. All gardeners. No. The resurrected body will be you yourself. Everybody will recognize you. It will be the real you, not this camouflage. This is camouflage. It's changing all the time.
The real you, the real me, you'll find. You'll be recognized one of them, inshallah.
So she's supposing him to be the guy, no? Says, sir, munyar, as ye hom, lechad rahet. If you have taken him hence, say for me, war ye hom, near halahet.
Tell me, where have you laid him?
To rest, to relax, to recuperate, and excel hom, wehaniyam. And ek,
alone. Sal hom, him, not it, a dead rotting body. Wehaniyam.
That I may take him away. I said, where?
What does she want to do with a dead rotting body? After 3 days? Take him home, put him under a bed, pickle him. What does she want to do with a rotting body, I ask you? No, she's not looking for a dead rotten body. She's looking for a live person. She was about the only woman, besides Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, who had given the final rites to the body of Jesus. She was there. So if she had seen signs of life, she was not going to shout and tell the Jews, he's alive, he's alive, because they'll make doubly sure that they kill him.
So after 3 days, she goes there and she wants to handle him, treat him, help him, take him away for treatment. And excel home recommend. The joke has gone too far. So Jesus says, Mary. The way he said, Mary, she recognized that this is Jesus. You know, all of us, we have our unique ways of calling our near ones, our dear ones. We have. I might know your wife's name, but the way you call her and the way I'm going to call that name is not the same. You agree? We have our unique ways, everybody. So we said, Mary. We said, Mary. She recognized Jesus, so she wants to grab him. To do what? To bite him? No. To pay respects. We Eastern people. His master, her master. So he says, Rak me ni ani, touch me not. I said, why not? Is he a bundle of electricity, a dynamo, that if she touches him, she'll get electrocuted? No. Then I said, why not? I said, because it hurts. You tell me why. For I'm not yet ascended unto my Father.
As is she blind? Can't she see the man is standing there beside her? What does it mean, I'm not gone up when he's here?
I said, in the language of the Jew, in the idiom of the Jew, he's saying, I'm not dead yet. So, from there, we find, he tells her, gives her advice to go and tell his brethren that he is risen. So she goes and tells them. An amazing thing, these disciples of Jesus. Amazing, amazing reactions. Mark chapter 16, verse 11. And they, the disciples, when they heard that he was alive, that he was alive, A-L-I-V-E, alive, not resurrected. This is the scripture, Mark 16:11, that he was alive and had been seen by her, by Mary Magdalene. She says, she saw him alive. They believed not. The Bible says they didn't believe. The woman says, look, I saw him, he's alive. And they didn't believe. Why didn't they believe? She's testifying that, look, I met him, I spoke to him. And they didn't believe. Why would they not believe? Because at the back of their minds, this man Jesus was dead. And she's talking about a live person. If she had said she's seen the ghost of Jesus, the spook of Jesus, the spirit of Jesus, they would have believed. But she's not talking about spook and ghost and fear. She's talking about the man, he's alive. Because they believe spirits going into pigs. See, it's in the Bible. The spirits went into pigs and 2,000, they heard of them, they ran down the hill and they all got drowned. Spirits going into pigs, they saw. They saw with their own eyes, spirits going into pigs. They saw a spirit going into trees and tying them up from the very roots, they saw. They believe anything. But to believe that the living Jesus is alive, that they couldn't believe. If she said, I saw his spook, they would have believed. His spook was alright, but not him. No, look, I'm only quoting. She said, he's alive, and they didn't believe. The disciples wouldn't believe. He's going to Emmaus. On the way to Emmaus, he's got two disciples of his walking side by side. And he's preaching to them about what had happened the previous 3 days. 5 miles they walk, and they still can't recognize the man. I ask you why. He's disguised, like Paul Mooney in The Good Earth. I don't know what he says. Hey, he looks like a real, the king and I. That, what's that word?
deal bringer. You know, when these guys, when they take those parts, you think the guy was Indonesian or Indochinese, Siamese, the Siamese king. You believe that when you see the guys on the screen, you believe that the guy is a Siamese king when he's a European, he's a Jew. Yulbrana. When he acts as part of Pharaoh in the Ten Commandments, you think that he is Pharaoh, he's an Egyptian. No. No, that's so realistic. So Jesus Christ has got such a fantastic disguise. He's talking with his disciples 5 miles and they don't recognize the man. Why? Because he's disguised, not because he's resurrected. He's disguised. So when they reach Emmaus, he makes it that he's going to carry on. So they say, come, come, it's time to eat. Come and join us. So he's persuaded. When he's persuaded, and it came to pass, Luke tells us, chapter 24, verse 30. And it came to pass, as he sat eating with them, he took bread and blessed it. They said, the manner in which he broke bread, the eyes were opened. It means, what does it mean, the eyes were opened? It means they recognized the man. It didn't mean they were walking 5 miles with eyes closed. Look, this is a figure of speech. It means now they recognized the man, the eyes were open, not that they were walking 5 miles with closed eyes. The eyes were open, they recognized the man. So when they recognized the man, Jesus vanished. What did he do? The Indian rope trick? You know, going up the rope and vanishing? No. He vanished means he went away, out of sight. So these disciples, they run to their upper room, where they had the Last Supper, and they find the others there. There were other eight there. Eight were there. And they go and tell them, say, you know, Jesus, he was with us, and he sat down to eat, and you know the way he was breaking bread, the way he was blessing it. Like we say, Bismillah. They say, Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Malach Haolam Hamotzi Lacham Min Haaretz. This is the Hebrew way of saying Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Get started. So the way he said it, they recognize that this is Jesus. So he vanished. He said, man, these guys now are in danger. They might go and tell everybody and I get into trouble. So they run to that upper room. They're telling them, say, Jesus, he's there. He was with us. And they say, I can't believe. And they said, we can't believe. And in came Jesus. Some said he stood in the midst. Like that vanishing trick, you know, that these guys in Star Trek, you see in your TV sets. You know, the guys, they dematerialize and they materialize somewhere and they dematerialize. You think they did something like that? Or nothing like that. In came Jesus. The door's been shut. That doesn't mean he came in through the keyhole. You know, like this. You see sometimes in films they show you, you know, the smoke coming out and materializing into a jinn. Genie. No. He didn't say he, through the crevice in the wall, he crept through. Nothing of the kind. The doors were shut. This was a mansion. My humble home in Verulam, we got 4 entrances, my humble home. This is a mansion, an upper room. Surely there were other rooms, other ways and means of getting into the house. I don't know how these brothers got there. I don't know how they got there. Look at them. Look. How did they get there? I don't know. But there must be a way. They didn't go and materialize and dematerialize from there. There must be a way. I don't know. So in that upper room he goes in, the doors were shut, and they're terrified. The disciples were terrified. I'm asking, why were they terrified? When you meet your long lost master, your uncle, your grandfather, we Eastern people, we embrace one another, we kiss one another. Why should the disciples of Jesus be terrified? So Luke tells us that they were affrighted because they thought he was a spirit. Luke chapter 24 verse 37. They thought he was a spirit. I'm asking, did he look like a spirit? He says, no. Then I said, why should they think the man is a spirit when he didn't look like one? Perfect. I said, I'll tell you why. You see, the disciples of Jesus, they had heard from hearsay that the master was hanged on the cross. They had heard from hearsay, Sunni Hui Bak, what they had heard, that he was hanged on the cross, that he had given up the ghost, he had died. And now he's dead and buried for 3 days. A man with such a reputation, you expect him to be stinking in his grave. Such a person, when you see, naturally you're terrified. See the reason why they are terrified? Because they were not there. They were not eyewitnesses or your witnesses of the happening. Because Mark chapter 14, verse 50, he says, for all his disciples forsook him and fled. To had almal from farlat and khaflat. Almal. I'm asking the Afrikaner, does almal mean almal in your language? Does it mean all? You Englishmen, does all mean all in your language? You Zulu, does bonke mean bonke in your language? Serious. So they were not there. All the knowledge is from hearsay, what they had heard. So now they are terrified. They think he's a ghost. So Jesus wants to assure them that is not what they're thinking. They're thinking he's a ghost, he's come back from the dead. So he says, cake na me hand and me footer. Cake. Have a look at my hands and my feet. Once it is excelled, that it is I myself. And the same fellow man, damn fools, what are you afraid of me for? Fool on me and cake. Handle me and see. Once a chies at me, please and dear na, so was zelatine that they kept me. For a spirit has no flesh and bones, as you see me have. So if I were flesh and bones, in that case, I'm not a spirit, I'm not a ghost, I'm not a spook. I say, is that what it means in your language, you Englishman? He said, yes. And you Afrikaner? He said, yes. And you Arab? He said, unzuru ila yadayya wa rijalayya. He says, behold my hands and my feet. In me, ana huwa, that it is I myself. Husuni wanzuru, handle me and see. Fa inna ruha laysa lahu lahmun wa izamun. But the spirit has no flesh and bones. In any language, every language, it is so simple and straightforward. But how people can be programmed, brainwashed. People can be brainwashed, we too. We must be on guard. People can be brainwashed. They're reading something and seeing something else. They're not seeing what is there. They're reading something in their own mother tongue and then somebody is making them to understand just the opposite of what they're reading. Just exact opposite. Not what is written there, but opposite. He said, a spirit has no flesh and bones. They say, a spirit has flesh and bones. Fine. Jesus said, a spirit has no flesh and bones. In other words, he's not resurrected. He's telling them that he's not resurrected because the resurrected body gets spiritualized. So the clever fellow says, who says so? I said, Jesus. You say, where? I said, Luke chapter 20, verse 36. If you're talking about 24, 36, go back, four chapters, you'll find it there, what Jesus says. So what does he say? I said, you know, the Jews, we're always coming to Jesus with poses and riddles. Want to make a fool of him. Want to make a mockery of him. Now they come to him, they said, Master, in the Hebrew language, Rabbi, like Sheikh, Imam. Master, Rabbi. Maulvi Sahib, Maulana. Says, there was a woman among us, a Jewess. And that woman had seven husbands. Seven husbands she had, according to Jewish practice. You see, the Jews, they had that custom that if one brother died, and if he had no offspring, then the second fellow takes a wife. And when he fails, the third. And when that guy fails, the fourth, and the fifth, and the sixth, and the seventh. Seven guys had this one woman, one after another. But there was no problem, because it was one by one. Now they want to know from Jesus that at the resurrection, Yawm al-Qiyamah, when everybody wakes up same time, from Adam to eternity, then seven brothers also waking up same time and they see this woman, they say, Mefro. Everybody say, Mefro. There's a war in heaven between the brothers. This is mine. The other guy says, this is mine. There's a fight. Seven brothers, because they all had her, they want to have her on the other side. So they want to know which guy is going to have her on the other side. Because they all had her here. This is what the Bible says. They all had her here, so they want to have her on the other side. Which guy is going to have him? Who will be entitled to have her on the other side? In answer to that, Jesus says, neither shall they die anymore. Once they are resurrected, they will be immortalized. This is a mortal body, which is what is mortal needs, food, shelter, clothing, sex, rest. Without these things, no Indians left, no Afrikaners left, no Malays left, nothing. That body will be an immortal body. No food, no shelter, no clothing, no sex, no rest. He said, neither shall they die anymore, for they are equal unto the angels, meaning they will be angelized. They will be spiritualized. They will be spiritual creatures. They will be spirits. For they are equal unto the angels and the children of God. Such are the children of the resurrection, spirits. He says, when he has had me flesh and Vienna, so as well as seen that he had me. A spirit has no flesh and bones. I am not resurrected. Can't you see? Simple, basic knowledge. Why does he have to convince anybody that a spirit has no flesh and bones? You don't have to prove it to an atheist, to an agnostic, to a Hindu, to a Jew, anybody, everybody. We believe that the spirits have no flesh and bones. Because they are thinking, he is a spirit, he's come back from the dead. So he's saying, I'm not there. Can't you see, you fools, what's wrong with you? And they believe not for joy. They are overjoyed and wondered what happened. So he says, have you here any meat, something to eat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish and a honeycomb. And he had a bit khaniyam and fuer hala uwaha yet. And he took it and he ate in the very sight as if to prove what? There is a ghost, there is a spirit, there is resurrected. Resurrected bodies eat broiled fish and honeycomb, do they? He's proving to you, I'm the same fellow man, what's wrong with you fools? Look, Mary Magdalene says, he was alive. You know, the other disciples, when they said, look, he's alive, they said, and they believe not. Now, these 10, they tell Thomas. Thomas wasn't there. They said, look, the master was here, and he ate with us, broiled fish and honeycomb. He says, I will not believe. What will he not believe? Imagine, just doubting Thomas. He's become famous for doubting. Thomas, this was his name. He said, I will not believe. Why won't he believe? Because they're telling him he's a living Jesus. He's alive, not his ghost. He said, look, we saw the ghost of Jesus. They see them every day. In those days, they're seeing them every day. No, they're not talking about ghost, about spook, about spirit. They're talking about him, himself, the man eating broiled fish and honeycomb. He said, I will not believe. 8 days later, Jesus comes again. Now he sees this guy. Thomas is a Thomas. He says, thy finger, and behold my hand, and put your hand into my side, and don't be faithless. Now he realizes what a fool he was. So he says, my God, my Lord. So now the Christians say he recognized that Jesus is his God and his Lord. Seriously. You know, he exclaimed, you go and report me to the special branch. The Deedat was preaching communism here. To you all, communism. So they come along, give me, harass me, they give me trouble, and they tell me eventually, he says, you know, he says, look, it's your friend, man. Who? Mr. Muhammad. He says, he is the guy who was, you know, prodding us. So, when I meet him, he broad smiling, says, my benefactor, my friend. I say, Sali, my God, what a thing to do. Sali, my God. He's my God? I say, Sali, Allah, what a thing you have done. Sali, Allah, you Allah? What's wrong with you people? This is an exclamation, what a fool that I was, man. The 10 disciples telling that he is alive, and I said, I will not believe. What reason did they have to lie? All the 10, he disbelieved them all. Why? Because they were telling that he was alive. Now, you know this crucifixion. It has become a joke by God. It has become a joke. You know, the way they have been trying to tell us about what a thing it was, it is not so serious as people have been preaching all along. In the Philippines, in the footsteps of Jesus, you'll find in this book of mine, page 85, don't open it now, don't open it now. Page 85, you'll find an article from Dar es Salaam of the Sunday News. You'll find there, Jesus' footsteps. And you find in there that this crucifixion, that 7 persons, let me read it to you. It says here, on Good Friday, at least 7 cases of crucifixion were reported in the local press. But the word crucifixion is in inverted commas. 6 times in this article, the word crucifixion occur, and every time in inverted commas. You know what that means? It means they were not crucifixion. It means the so-called. You see, when it is in inverted commas, this is where people talk about crucifixion, that it was not really crucifixion. In inverted commas. Instead of writing every time the so-called crucifixion, the newspaper loses its value. So they don't want to tell you really, but they put it in inverted commas. This reporter, Greg Grattan, you know, he had the brains, he knew what he was doing. 6 times, every time, the word crucifixion is in inverted commas, meaning it was not really the crucifixion. Listen. On Good Friday, at least 7 cases of crucifixion were reported in the local press. One of these was Luciana Reyes, a 23-year-old factory worker and the first woman known to have performed the ritual. First woman got crucified. But she wasn't crucified because she was alive. She lived. She's still living. See? So what do you call that? These Christians, this attorney from Benoni, a born-again Christian, and this guy Josh McDowell, they wrote a book. And in that, they are asking me the question. They haven't got a word in their language for a person going on the cross and going through the ordeal and not dying. Would you say he was crucified when 20 years later somebody shot him, or 20 years later he was hanged? or 5 years later a motor car knocked him down. What was his end? Crucified? No. What happened on the cross? There is no word in the English language. For that they're making a mockery of me. I said, I'll supply you the word. Well, these educated fools, I tell you, fools. They haven't got a word in their own language to tell us what happened. A man is taken to the gallows. The noose is pulled around his neck. The rope is pulled. But before the man expires, they cut the rope. Was the man hanged? What? One word. Give me one word in your language. There isn't. You haven't got a word in your language to describe that. Is that my fault? I said, what it is? It is not crucifixion in inverted commas. It is crucifixion. These are fictions taking place. These are fairy tales. Then. So, a woman now. A woman is doing that. She did it. First woman to do that. The crucifixion, some shown live on television, they show them alive on television, have now become the climax of Easter week in the Philippines. In some cases, they attract thousands of visitors to provincial towns where the atmosphere is a blend of carnival and deep mourning. Something, suggestion for our Christian brethren here. What about enacting something here in Siri or somewhere around here in Bontiwal? Look, you'll get thousands of people coming along to see the fun. They're doing it in the Philippines. They're getting themselves hung on the cross. Nailed. And they're not dying. It's because they're doing it for kicks. You know, kicks for enjoyment, for pleasure. One man fainted. After being removed from the cross, he had to be carried to a waiting bus. Another was up and smoking a cigarette as soon as his hands were bandaged. These are the crucified people. Would you call them crucified or crucifixed? They're not crucified, crucifixed. And what's taking place is crucifixion. F-I-C-T-I-O-N, fiction, not F-I-X-I-O-N. It's not crucifixion, it is crucifixion. F-I-C-T-I-O-N, it's a fiction taking place. And they're doing the real thing, not like what they do in films. They just try and show you, as if the man is getting, you know, like these films you see, Jesus of Nazareth, the Day of Triumph, King of Kings. They show the man, you know, going through the ordeal. That's all acting, play acting. This is no play acting, they go through the real thing. But this is crucifixion. There are fictions, there are not crucifixions. One of them, Mario Baptist, a 33-year-old vendor, had gone through the ritual for the fifth time. He was crucified 5 times already. For the fifth time, every year he's going through the process. And like the Bacalor penitent, he promised to return next year. He said he had vowed to perform the crucifixion for 10 years. After his wife recovered from cancer, 10 years, he's going to do it 10 times. Every year he gets crucified. He's getting crucified. So he is getting crucifixed. And these are crucifixions. Fiction. You know, fable, fiction. These are fictions taking place. You don't have to go all the way to the Philippines. Too far. In Natal. Yeah, you see it on page 36 and 56 of the book I gave you. Pictures of a man in Natal in Newcastle. Crucified man hung on the cross, and he did something more than the Filipinos do. He put a spike through his thigh also to show that the man has his mind over matter. He's proving that, you know, the mind, what it can bear. And he's a barman, Funderburg, an Africana. He's done it, getting crucified on the cross, and then he's brought down. And a few days later, he's back to work. Would you say he was crucified? What would you call that? The newspaper, the crucified man hung on cross. Was he crucified? Crucified means to kill. The man is alive. One word. I said he was being crucifixed. And these are crucifixion. This is not F-I-X-I-O-N. You must call them fiction. These are crucifixion. They're playing with the game. And now the Christians, they give you a choice. They give you a choice. He's born again. That spirit is coming into them. You'll find that this man here, of the Campus Crusade, he publishes a book, The Resurrection Factor. In that book, on page 47, he shows us Jesus Christ on the cross. After 1,000 hours of actual study on the crucifixion, he comes along with this picture. You got the book? If you haven't, when you go out, you must get that book. It's absolutely free. You owe it to yourself. You must have it. His Lord and Savior, he put him up like a frog. Look, you'll see that. Page 47, you see, he's like a frog on the cross. Actually like a frog. So I'm asking now, is this froggy fiction, as illustrated here? Like a frog, I didn't do it. This is the Campus Crusade. publication, page 47, it's like a frog, you'll see it there on page 47. If you have the book, open it and see. Page 47. You must take it when you go out. Like a frog. Page 47. Huh? Oh, 87, I'm sorry. This is 47 of his book. In his book, page 47. I'm sorry. Yes. Right. Froggy fiction has in page 87. Then you see the Jehovah's Witnesses, they getting the cross stuck in the throat. The Jehovah's Witnesses. So they say, no, the Lord was stakeified. He was put on a stake, a totem pole. You find that on page 74. He's put on a stake like that. Not like this, like that. See that, page 74. So now that is stakey fiction. Look, they're giving you a choice. You can take your choice now. What? Froggy fiction or stakey fiction or crucifixion on page 33. It will show you that he was not nailed. Page 33, you see. What a choice. What a choice. The Christians are giving you now. Take your choice. Either your Lord was froggy fictive, or whether he was stakey fictive, or whether he was crucifixed. What? A choice. They're giving you numerous choices. See for yourself. We didn't do it. We are not theorizing. We don't say what happened, what not. So look, this is what you're telling us. Like a frog, like a stake, or like a cross. What did he do? What happened? Now, I will give you a quick summary. Number one, that this crucifixion is a fiction. That it didn't happen. The way the Christians claim, those things didn't happen. Number one, he was reluctant to die. He didn't want to die. He didn't come prepared to come for any type of sacrifice. Luke chapter 22 verse 36, you'll find he's preparing for a fight. Had he come to die, there was no need for him to tell his disciples to go and arm themselves. Number two, he beseeched God for help. Matthew chapter 26 verse 39. Number three, God heard his prayers. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 7. Number four, an angel of God came to strengthen him. Luke chapter 22 verse 43. Pilate finds Jesus not guilty. It's good reason to keep Jesus alive. John chapter 18 verse 38. Number six, Pilate's wife shown a dream in which she was told that no harm should come to this just man. In the other words, that he should be saved alive. Matthew chapter 27 verse 19. Number seven, supposed to be on the cross for only 3 hours. According to the system in vogue, no man could die by crucifixion in so short a time, which means that even if he was fastened to the cross, he was alive. Number eight, the other two, his crossmates on the respective crosses were alive. So Jesus too, for the same period of time, must be alive. John chapter 19 verse 32. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already. So what? That he was dead already. As you know, on page 36 and 37 and 38, I give you a list of 11 different persons in the newspapers who were certified dead and they were not dead. By doctors with stethoscopes, they were pronounced dead and they were not dead. They came back to life. And there is a society in England, I have given you the picture of the society of people who have come back from the dead. Were they all resurrected? No. But they were certified dead. This man, seeing a person on the cross, he thought he was dead and he saw that he is dead already. I said, what does it mean, and saw? When doctors make mistakes in the Crucifixion hospital, where Chris Barnard operates, a white woman was put, certified dead and put in the mortuary, next morning she came out alive. When you make mistakes by the day, certifying people dead when they're not dead. What does it mean that he was dead already? So I said, Jesus was, John 19:33, that there was a mistake there in seeing. Number 9, Encyclopedia Biblica, under article cross, column 960 says that when the spear was thrust, Jesus was alive. We didn't write the Encyclopedia Biblica. Number 10, and when they launched him on the side with the spear, so forthwith they came out blood and water, which is a sign of life. Number 11, his legs not broken as a fulfillment of prophecy. I said, legs can be of any use only if Jesus was alive. And this is the fulfillment of prophecy, says the Christian. He keepeth all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Psalms chapter 24, verse 20. Number 12. There was a thunderstorm, earthquake, and darkening of the sun, all within 3 hours. to disperse the sadistic mob to enable his secret disciples to help keep him alive. Number 13, the Jews doubted his death. They suspected that he had escaped death on the cross, that he was alive. And now the next day, they go to Pilate, the chief priests and Pharisees come together into Pilate saying, "Sir, we remember so and so, and we don't want to make another mistake like we had made in the first, that the last error shall be worse than the first error." What was the first error they made? You know what? They allowed the body to come down without breaking his legs. Now they want to make doubly sure, but they missed the bus. The Jews missed the bus. You know, yesterday, last night, there was in the August that they didn't miss the bus. In Palestine, you know, within 24 seconds, 25 seconds, they killed three Arabs, and you know, who were out to do some terrorist business, they killed three. They didn't miss the bus there. But here, in the Bible, Matthew chapter 27, verses 62 to 64, they missed the bus. Because the next day they go along to make the sepulchre secure. Next day, after the horse has bolted, you go and lock the gate. There's something wrong with you. The Bible says, next day. Pilate, number 14, Pilate marvels to hear that Jesus was dead. So Pilate marveled if he were already dead. And calling to him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead. Mark chapter 15, verse 44. You only marvel if you know the thing that they're talking didn't happen. If you take a man to a firing squad and you put 6 bullets through him, and if he dies, there's nothing to marvel. But if he didn't die, you marvel. Now Pilate marvels that, look, no man can die within 3 hours. In other words, according to his experience, the man is alive. Number 15, big and roomy chamber, close at hand, and big and airy for willing hands to come to the rescue. Providence was out to keep Jesus alive. Number 16, stone and winding sheet had to be removed. Only necessary if Jesus was alive. John chapter 20, verse 1. Number 17. Report on the winding sheets. German scientists who carried out experiments on the Shroud of Turin said that the heart of Jesus had not stopped functioning, that he was alive. Number 18. He was ever in disguise. Disguise not necessary if Jesus was resurrected. Only necessary if he was alive. John chapter 21, verse 4. Number 19, he forbade Mary Magdalene to touch him. Touch me not, for this reason that it would hurt, because he was alive. John chapter 20, verse 17. Number 20, not yet ascended unto my Father. In the language of the Jew, in the idiom of the Jew, he was saying, I am not dead yet. In other words, I am alive. John chapter 20, verse 17. Number 21, Mary Magdalene not afraid on recognizing Jesus, because she had seen signs of life before. She was looking for a Jesus who was alive. John chapter 20, verse 16. Number 22. His disciples petrified on seeing Jesus in the upper room. All the knowledge about the crucifixion was from hearsay. Therefore, they could not believe that Jesus was alive. To het almal hum sarlat and safla. They were not there. Number 23. At food again and again in his post-crucifixion appearances. Food only necessary if he was alive. Luke chapter 24, verse 43. Number 24. Never showed himself to his enemies, because he had escaped death by the skin of his teeth. He was alive. Number 25. Took only short trips, because he was not resurrected, not spiritualized, but alive. He went to Emmaus. He went to the upper room. Back again after 8 days. He only took short trips, because he was not resurrected, otherwise he would have gone up to heaven. No sense in going and coming back, up and down, not from heaven to down and up above. He's going around, in and around Jerusalem all the time. Number 26, testimony of men around the tomb. They say, why seek ye the living among the dead? Why are you looking for a live person among dead people in the cemetery? Luke chapter 24, verse 4 and 5, that he is not dead, but alive. Why seek ye the living among the dead? Number 27, testimony of the angels. The angels say, the angels who had said that he was alive, that he liver, that he is alive. What's wrong with people? What are you reading? The angels, what did they say? That he is resurrected. No, he said, that he liver, he is alive. They said, no, he is not alive, he is dead. He did not say resurrected, but the actual word uttered by the angel was alive. Luke chapter 24, verse 23. 28. Mary Magdalene testified. They heard that he was alive and had been seen by her. They believed not. Mark 16:11.
Mary did not watch for a spook or a ghost or spirit of Jesus, but a live Jesus. What they could not believe was that the Master was alive. Mark 16:11, number 29. Dr. Primrose, a senior anesthetist at the Royal Glasgow Infirmary, he says that the water in the blood was an account of scourging by stays and upset of the nervous vessels, that which was a sure sign that Jesus was alive. And now, the last and final one for tonight, Jesus had himself foretold that he was going to remain alive. Matthew 12:38-40. He himself had told that he was not to die. That is his prophecy. The Jews come to him again. They were coming again and again, making a mockery of the master, rabbi, meester, onsul schrach, a teken van isin. So master, we would have a sign of thee. We want you to show us a miracle to convince us that you are the man we are waiting for. You are our Messiah. And Jesus answered and sefer hala, an slechter en uur spelliges geslaag, soek na a teken en geen teken sal aan hom gegee word nie. An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after the sign, but there shall no sign be given unto it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. Want suath Jonah, drie da and drie nachta. In the heart and the fruit this was, so shall the seen from the man, drie da and drie nachta, in the heart from the earth of this. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. The only sign, he said, I'm prepared to give you is this, the sign of Jonah. And we are asking of a Christian brethren, what was that sign? You know what was the sign of Jonah? Go to the book of Jonah. This is the book of Jonah. This is the book of Jonah, one page in the Bible. I enlarge it for you. It's hard to find. But you find it. You don't have to even go to it. If anybody has been to Sunday school, he knows the whole story. This is the book. This is the book of Jonah. I'm not exaggerating. There is only one page in the Bible called the book of Jonah, this one here, front and back, four short chapters. It won't take you 2 minutes to read it, but you don't have to do that. Everybody knows the story. The Hindu knows it, the Christian knows it, the Muslim knows it, the Jew knows it, everybody knows about Jonah. Jonah in the whale. So Jesus says, the sign, the miracle that I'm going to show you is the miracle of Jonah. So we are asking, what miracle did Jonah perform? So you go to the book of Jonah, and you read there that Jonah was sent to the Ninevites, a city called Nineveh, of 100,000 people. God Almighty tells him, go to Nineveh and warn the people that they must repent in sackcloth and in ashes, meaning they must humble themselves before the Lord. But Jonah, instead of going to Nineveh, he goes to Joppa, and he's running away. He's going to Tarshish. Because he's despondent that these materialistic people, wicked and adulterous generation of his time, they will not listen to me. So, presumptuously, he is running away. And actually, there's a storm. And according to the superstitions of these people, anybody who runs away from his master's command creates such a turmoil at sea. So they began to question who can be responsible. So Jonah, Yunus, Hadrat Yunus alayhi salam, Jonah now realizes that he's a guilty man because he's running away from his master's command. So he volunteers. He said, look, I'm the guilty man. God is after my blood. And he's going to sink the boat to kill me, and in the process you innocent people will die. You rather take me and you throw me overboard, it'll be all right for you. He makes a manly comeback. They say, no. You might be wanting to commit suicide. You want us to help you? No. We have our own system of finding out right from wrong. What is called casting of lots, like head or tail. And according to that system, it came to the turn of Jonah that Jonah was the guilty man. So they took him and they threw him overboard. We are asking of a Christian brother that when they threw him overboard, was he dead or was he alive? But to make it easy for them, we have to tell them that, look, this man volunteered. And when a man volunteers, you don't have to strangle him before throwing. When a man volunteers, you don't have to spear him before throwing. When a man volunteers, you don't have to break his arm or limb before throwing. Am I right? He volunteered. He said, throw me. So when they threw him overboard, was he dead or was he alive? What do you say? What do you say? Tell me, quickly. Alive. A little more loud. I want to hear it from your mouth. Alive. A fish comes and gobbles him up. Dead or alive? Alive. From the fish's belly, he's praying to God for help. Do dead people pray? No. So he was? Alive. 3 days and three nights, the fish takes him around the ocean. Dead or alive?
alive. On the third day, vomiting on the seashore, alive. Look, Jesus said, for as Jonah was, so shall the Son of Man be. The only miracle. He didn't say, blind Fatimah, I healed him. You know that woman with issues, she was bleeding for ages and she touched me and she got healed. You know those 2,000 pigs I destroyed? You know the fig tree I dried it up from its very roots? Nothing. You know Lazarus, I brought him back from the dead? Nothing. The only sign I'm giving you is the sign of Jonah. What happened to Jonah is going to happen to me. The miracle of Jonah is my miracle. So we are asking, how was Jonah? Dead or alive? And the Jews say he was alive. And the Christians say he was alive. And the Muslims say he was alive. For 3 days and three nights, the man was alive through and through. It's a miracle. It's a miracle that you throw a man into a raging sea and he doesn't die. It's a miracle. A fish gobbles a man, he ought to die. He didn't die. It's a miracle. 3 days and three nights, suffocation and heat in the whale's belly, he ought to die. He didn't die. It's a miracle. It's a miracle of a miracle of a miracle. Can you see? Impossibility. But that's what makes it a miracle, a sign. Now, ask our Christian brethren. How was Jesus in the tomb for 3 days and three nights? 1,200 million Christians, they say he was dead.